How you guys doing today? Man, there's horns up here. There's things happening. That's some cool stuff right there, I'll tell you what. So when you were coming in this morning, you received a digest, and inside the digest, you also received one of these bookmarks right here. And we want to encourage everybody at Redemption to be a part of Smash Bible 2016. This is our journey through the Old Testament. And so all of 2015 has been going through the New Testament, scribbling in the margins, highlighting things, just noting things that stand out in different ways. And now we get to do it in the Old Testament. And in some ways, we did the New Testament first to kind of get us ready, you know, for the Old Testament. But the cool part about that is that you know how it ends. So when you go and you read the beginning and go like, wow, this is dark, right? You can see why they longed for the coming Messiah. In fact, I think that bleeds right into our Advent season. As we are thinking about the Old Testament and what they longed for, we get to celebrate that in hindsight. We get to enjoy in a very different way the reality that we are on this side of the coming one and how much that has shaped and changed our lives. And so this morning, we're going to continue with our Advent season. I'm going to start with a word of prayer, and then we'll see what we can see from Jesus today. Jesus, I thank you for, again, this time of year. I thank you for the reflection that it brings upon us. And I pray that as we do that reflection, as we think about that, this truth that you have come into the world and 2,000 years ago you changed everything, I pray that we would allow that truth to ground us maybe even more than it does. I think there's this tendency very easily for us to look around at our world to see the brokenness or the problems or the hurt or the unmet expectations, the frustrations. We can even let this season with its busyness and parties and shopping and traffic and just a mass of people sometimes even let it get us down, or problems with family or whatever else, and we can forget rapidly how profound it is that you came into the world to change us. And so I pray that we will carve out sections of reflection, and that from that, those will then inflate and fill up our perspectives in you. And so as we go into your word this morning, I pray that we find encouragement, and I pray that we find strength in you, and that we will be drawn back to yourself as the source of all hope and all joy and all peace and all love. We thank you, Jesus, so much in your good and awesome name. Amen. So I'm curious this morning. We started off the season of Advent last Sunday, but how many families actually do Advent just as a family? Is there many people that do that? There's a few of you. That's awesome, actually. I'm a huge fan of that. We, as a family, we've been doing Advent since our kids were really, really small. And when you start off with little kids doing Advent, the first real challenge is you're bringing children and fire together. And so, like, our kids were like, we want to light the candle, we want to light the candle. They all wanted to light the candle, so we let all three of them hold the lighter, you know, but then you have them all kind of jockeying, so like three little hands, fire, you know, we're like, we're going to burn the house down, or at least light the dog on fire, something's bad going to happen here, but we've been doing it for years, and now our kids are 19, 17, and 15, and it's fun to still do it, and we have this Advent book where there's little doors for all the days leading up to December 25th, and it's fun to see my basically adult-type kids still loving this as like little kids, you know? And so this is my encouragement to us, is find those traditions around this time of year, whether it be Advent or something else, find those things, and especially those with little children, and ground your kids in that, because it really does stick. It really does kind of draw you back to what the reason for the season is all about, because it is all about Jesus. That's what we're celebrating. And so with the first Sunday of Advent, we celebrate hope. And in our series that we're looking at, we acknowledge the fact that hope was set against the backdrop of despair. It was set against the backdrop of grief and hopelessness, right? It's like hope becomes more vivid when there is a surrounding that seems like there cannot be hope. It's too broken, it's too lost, it's too adrift for hope, and yet in the midst of that, God brings hope. This morning, we look at the second word of Advent, and that word is joy. Joy. And that there's a joy to be found even in a context where you may be surrounded by sorrow. You may have people of sorrows, circumstances of sorrows, a context of sorrows, but in the center of that, God desires to deposit joy. And that's so much what the story of Christmas is all about. It's about joy, even in the midst of hardship or pain or brokenness. So much so that now it is a word that is just connected to the holiday season. You're going to go to the mall. You're going to be walking through the mall, and out of nowhere, you're going to hear the song, Joy to the World, at the mall in the Northwest, the liberal Northwest. Right? So, and it's just going to be there. Why? Because we're so used to it. Like, yes, joy to the world, or repeat the sounding joy. Or people are going to say, have a joyous holiday season. These are going to be the things that we see and hear. You're going to see wrapping paper with great big letters, J-O-Y. You're going to go to outings, and you're going to see that word plastered everywhere. There is this longing for joy. There's this hope that this time of year will bring joy to people. Everybody is buying presents and wrapping them and putting up their trees, and they're just hoping that they're going to have a great holiday season marked by joy. Now, the reason I think joy is such a part of the holiday season is because it is directly linked to God. Right? I mean, this is the thing, right? So we think about, what is Christmas really about? It's about the birth of Jesus. And Jesus is God. And God is contagiously and infectiously and unstoppably joy-filled. God is a radically joyous God. Now, when I say that right now, there may be some of you where the gears sort of grind a little bit. Right, where you go, what do you mean that God is joyous or joy-filled or the most joyous one of all? Because we tend to see God in slightly more stoic ways than God being joyful. You know what I mean? We have a lot of other pictures. I think some of us almost picture God like Jim Harbaugh, right? Where he just, most of the time he's looking at the world going, in his khakis, in his pen hanging, just, and until he gets mad. You know, and then he's back there. Right? Like, that's how we see God. Like, he's just always looking at the human race, like Jim Harbaugh, like somebody just looking in his Wheaties that morning, and now he's just not pleased with you, but I'm not mad yet, but wait, you know, like that. Or like God works at the DMV, or he's a 49er fan, just unhappy, whatever your version of unhappy is, right? Like, we see God as unhappy because he deals with this world that all the time is engaged in conflict and war and pain and suffering and people against people and lies and deceit and all kinds of just messes. And we do. We almost would think like God spends most of his time bummed out and on the verge of angry. But that's not the full description of God. There are times that, yes, God is angered at sin, and God can exude wrath and circumstance. But what we see as a steady state in God as well is the fact that God is joy-filled. In fact, in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 11, Paul is talking about the gospel. And he says, it is the gospel of the glory of the blessed God. Right? And as Christians or people of faith, we hear that word blessed, and we've almost kind of sanitized it into like a spiritual word. Like, oh, are you blessed? I'm blessed. Bless you too. Move on. All right, like we've kind of lost that this word has some depth to it, right? And when the gospel writers or the writers of the letters of the New Testament are using this word, it is like happiness on steroids that can never be robbed. It is so utterly happy. It is a happiness that we rarely experience. It is a happiness of transcendence. It's a happiness of profound depth. And so when we see that God is the blessed God, he is a profoundly, deeply, transcendently happy God. Not happy in the way we use it. We use happy in very simple ways. right? We use happy in fleeting ways, in vaporous ways. God is a supremely happy God. This is why later in Matthew 25, there's a scene where there's different people that have made investments. Jesus is telling a story about investing into heaven versus earth. And the ones that have invested and seen return, the thing that he says to them is, he says, now enter into the joy of your master. He's talking about entering into the joy of God, right? So one of the first things we need to do when we start talking about the season of joy is we have to start thinking in terms of, wait, God is joy-filled. God is transcendently, deeply, abundantly, profoundly filled with joy. And from Matthew 25, we are invited to enter into that joy, right? A joy that is so different than the way the world wants to architect things. See, that's what we're invited to. And so through the holiday season, when we think about joy, we want to think about God. The reason that joy is so much a part of the Christmas season is because Christmas is about Jesus. Jesus is God, and God is infinitely joy-filled. From this, what we see when we study through the New Testament in particular is that joy is one of the most spoken of byproducts of the Christian life and the Christian faith. Because if God is joyful and that he calls others to himself in this gospel of his, this gospel of the blessed, joy-filled, happy God, then the consequence of that is those who are called into that gospel are then imparted with that same type of joy. That's at least to be the mark of the Christian life. It's a movement of joy. In fact, if you were just to read through the New Testament and circle every time you see the word joy, and then circle in a different color every time you see the word grace, what you would be surprised by is that joy comes up two times more often than even a word like grace, right? So we think about the benchmark of our faith, saved by the grace of God, and then you read through and you realize, oh, but joy is the abundant overflow of that grace. Whether it be rejoicing or joy-filled or just speaking of joy, that is to be the place things exist. And I think about Paul. Here was this guy, man. He preached the gospel of grace. He was always letting people know, it's by the grace of God, it's through the grace of God, it's because of the grace of God that we stand. But then, boy, Paul, he stood in that grace by exhibiting joy. Joy that did not take any sense of ownership of conditions being the thing that drives the joy. Right? So he might be in prison and he says, rejoice. He might have people actually just trying to make his life bad, and he says, you know what, I'm marked by joy. I'm touched by joy. I'm driven by joy. I'm motivated by this joy. He spoke of joy and rejoicing all of the time, and most of the circumstances weren't great. And that's what I love about this concept of joy in the Bible. It's that it says, you know what, you can have it without having to have the conditions cooperate with you to have it. You can have access to it, and you can look at all the world around you that may be collapsing and say, you cannot touch this in me. That's the joy of the Advent season that we celebrate. Now with that, I guess the question comes up, well then why does joy seem so difficult for us? Right? I mean, right now, I'm sure you're sitting there listening going, that's right, preach it, brother, except we don't say preach it here. That's right, there's a joy. Joy's coming, joy's there, joy's deep, joy's wide, joy's from God, all of that. But then if I said, hey, are you joyful? You'd be like, I got this back pain, and, you know, I got this bunion, and, you know, it's a 10 o'clock game, you know, whatever else, right? And so if quizzed, do we have joy? Then we find that that's a little, we're more estranged from that idea, right, than maybe we should be. And part of it is because we struggle to really experience this fullness of joy. We acknowledge that it's for the Christian and it's from God, but then we struggle to really experience it. And so we end up often kind of giving our joy away, or we worry our joy away. We push it away. We allow it to be stolen away through circumstance, or we try to find joy in a series of different wrong ways. You know, we just chase down other outlets, hoping that that's going to be joy. It's not necessarily a God-centered joy. It's some other lesser thing. And then we can't figure out why we're always feeling like we're on this chase, trying to find the next happy thing, the next waypoint of joy. You know, we just sort of struggle with this inherently. Now, to understand the struggle, I take us back to where I keep taking us back. I'm always going to take us back to Genesis through Advent because I believe that is the source of telling us why do we struggle with these things. Now, in Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, I would contend that there was just contagious, infectious, unstoppable joy. Right? It was just, they were joy-filled. Adam was joy-filled. Eve was joy-filled. When God establishes Eve and brings Eve to Adam, Adam wakes up and says, wow, he's joy-filled. This is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. I mean, he is enthusiastic about what God has given to him. And it says, and they were naked and unashamed. They had nothing to hide. Have you ever hidden a secret or a lie in your life? Have you ever been afraid to be caught in something? The last thing you sense is joy in that circumstance. Well, Adam and Eve had nothing to hide, had nothing to be ashamed of, nothing they were afraid of. They had a perfect marriage, had a perfect relationship with God. They were perfectly joyful. Now, part of that is going to be related to the fact that there was no sin in their lives to drag them down. Sin always drags you down. Even if it's fun for a little while, it eventually locks its talons into your life and becomes miserable quickly. You don't believe me? Read the book of Judges, all right? And you will see, hey, this is fun. No, this is bad, right? And it drags you down, right? But so part of this joy that they had in Genesis 1 and 2 was that they didn't have sin. But there's another component why they had a profound joy in my estimation, and that is because they had unrestricted access to God. Unrestricted access to God. The fruit of that presence of God is joy. In fact, the psalmist in Psalm 16:11 writes about this. This is David. He says, you make known to me the path of life in your presence. Listen to this. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. And at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. So here's a king. He has strength. He has power. He has wealth. He has women. He has land. He has whatever he wants. And yet he says, you know what? None of that brings me joy. When I'm in your presence, there is a fullness of joy. At your right hand, that's where real pleasure's at. Pleasure is not in me conquering. It's not in me having. It's not in me owning. It's not in me controlling. It's in you, God. You are the fullness of joy. Where you are, there's pleasure. Right? So part of this unlocking of what we're getting at is saying, when we reflect on joy, we have to reflect on who the source of joy is, right? And in Genesis 1 and 2, the source of joy was God, as God is always the source of joy. And they had unrestricted access to the source of true joy. But then, as we know, in Genesis 3, there was all this crazy rebellion. So an enemy comes and starts probing and pushing and asking questions and leading people astray, and pretty soon Adam and Eve, they rebel against God, and they go down this road that they are not permitted to go down. And we see in Genesis 3, verse 8, that they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden of the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. Notice that. They hear God, and what is their first response? They hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. Now, why does this matter in a world of joy? Because in his presence is the fullness of joy. And now the human nature is covering itself. It's hiding itself. It's hiding away and saying, I don't want to be near the presence of God. Because the presence of God exposes me, and I don't want to be exposed. I want to coddle my little sin over here. I want to hold on to my own personal identity. I want to keep my thing as mine, and so I'm going to turn my back, and I'm going to hope I can find joy in this little isolated state. So they hide in their isolation and in their fear and in their insecurity, right? And so they estrange themselves from the opportunity for joy. They hide from the presence of the Lord. And so God starts to quiz, and they said, we heard the sound of you in the garden. And Adam says, I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. Not only do they run from the presence of God, but they also run to hide in light of their own personal insecurity. And an insecure person, you know what, is not a joyful person. An insecure person is anything but joyful. Now, they chase a lot of joy. They fight for a lot of happiness. They try to find contentment. They want to be recognized. Some of the most famous people in the world that you would look at and you see in tabloids or on television, whatever the outlet, and you might look and they're smiling and they're rich and you think, I bet they're filled with joy. And what you'll find out is most of them are radically insecure. It's just they're so aggressive in the pursuit that they seem to amass things around them, but there's not joy. There's just a lot of insecurity. Most human beings are insecure. Most human beings struggle to sense joy, and no wonder there's this sense of hiding from God. Right? Anytime you hide from God, you hide a lie, you hide your insecurity, it only builds a greater sense of absence of joy. And then you have God's response in verse 23 of Genesis 23. It says, the Lord God banished them from the Garden of Eden. So all the more, not only did they hide from the presence of the Lord, but the Lord said, you know what, I'm going to just escort you right out of Eden. So there's even greater distance, greater challenge when it comes to joy. And so they're hiding from the presence of God, hiding in their insecurity. They're banished in exclusion. And what that handed down to all of us was a race that would find joy difficult, that would find joy to be elusive, that would find life being like a series of mountain peaks and valleys where we could say, that was a really joyful time in my life, and we'll probably use the word happy. Say, that was happy, and that was happy, and that was happy, but there was a lot of these slopes and valleys. I'd slide down, I'd climb up, and then happy, and slide down, climb up, happy, and then those valleys, those were dark, those were depressing, those were a letdown, those were anxiety-filled, right? And we're going to feel like, boy, the real happy, joyful times are just few and far between in comparison. Right? And we're all going to identify with that. And we're going to identify with that at some level because that is the problem of Genesis 3. It's passed down. There's this new nature in us that's called a sinful nature that is riddled with kind of selfishness and self-identity and discontentedness and incompleteness and perpetual chasing and wanting the new little trinket to make us happy. And then, of course, we're only happy for a little while and then it vanishes again. That's why Disneyland's the happiest place on earth. You have to keep going back to there to be happy. Because work isn't the happiest place on earth, maybe. Sometimes your kids are not the happiest place on earth. Sometimes they are, and sometimes, oh, that's a little piece of hell on earth. Sometimes, right? You know? Except for, I'm sure a couple of you have little angels because you're on some kind of happy medicine. All right, so, right? But we just know life. Life is not always joy-filled, right? And that's just the plight of the human race. And this joylessness comes in a lot of different flavors, right? I mean, it's not like everybody's equally joyless in the same way. It's just different. And then people kind of try to pursue regenerating this joy that was lost in Eden in all sorts of different ways too. So some people are more optimistic, some people are more pessimistic. It kind of runs across the board. For example, there is person one who believes in joy. Right? They believe in joy, but instead of really pursuing joy, they pursue a very low quality of happiness, just something generally the world accepts as happiness, or they pursue pleasure. They say, I believe in joy. Even joy is a deep and profound word, that it's deeper than happiness. I believe in that, but you know what? That's hard. To have that joy takes real selflessness sometimes. You know, people will look at Mother Teresa and say, she probably wasn't happy, but she was really joyful. Because they'll say, that's deeper. She sacrificed for that deeper joy. But a lot of people don't want to sacrifice for deeper joy, so they say, I'll just settle for happiness. I'll settle for pleasure. So we're going to Disneyland, man, because that's easy. Buying the ticket hurts a little, but after that, you know, it's just happy, man. Cotton candy on Main Street, oh, so happy, right? So like that's that, or other things. You know, I'm just going to get an Xbox, man, because that's going to make me happy. I'm going to get the newest game. That's going to make me happy. I'm going to get a new dating relationship. It's going to make me happy. I'm going to, whatever it is, I'm going to have an awesome Christmas with 10,000 presents. It's going to make me happy because I want pleasure as the substitute for joy. This person's just kind of at their core a hedonist. I just want to be happy. I just want to be pleasure-filled. Yes, I know that I might have to find a new outlet for that happiness every day. But you know what? At least it's easy enough that I just have to find the new outlet. Maybe it's getting wasted. Maybe it's doing drugs. Maybe it's buying stuff. Maybe it's whatever it is. You know, 2 gallons of ice cream every night, it makes me happy. I don't know what it is. But that's just ultimately hedonist. And some people try to figure out joy by being a hedonist. Second person believes in joy, but they think joy is rare. This person is more of an existentialist. So they go, you know, I can conceive of joy. I think people, every once in a while, might have it. Again, you pick those people that are very sacrificial and just seem to really have it, but you're going to say, you know, philosophically speaking, more people are not going to have this joy, but I think it's possible, and they spend a lot of their time talking about what is true joy. And they're so busy, like, trying to figure out the architecture of joy that they just don't have it, but they're always pondering it, right? And there's some people that are like that. You know, you can think about what joy is, but you think it's rare. The third person just doesn't believe there's any real joy. But they just learn to cope, right? So they go, no, 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 it's not possible in this world. There's too many people against one another. There's too many nation versus nation, neighbor versus neighbor. There's government and politics and work politics and neighborhood politics and da-da-da. There's not going to be real joy. But you know what? I don't care. I don't care because I've got an Xbox. That's how they cope. You know, I don't care because at the end of the day, I've got my Seahawks. I just learned to cope. I just realized it's never going to be what everybody wants. But no big deal. I've got a Christmas tree. That's good enough for me, all right? And it's LED, and I can change the colors from white to colored anytime I want. That's awesome. So they cope. And there are some of those people. The fourth person believes there is no joy, and they're joyless. Right? And you know this person. I pray that you're not this person. I pray that you're not this person. But the person that says there is no joy and is joyless is making sure to let everybody around them know, by the way, there's no joy. How do I suck whatever joy you have out of your life, lay it on the ground, and stomp on it, right? They're that person. And so it's always negative, it's always wrong, it's always broken, it's always unfair, it's always just going to hell, it's just dark. You get around them and you feel like, you know what? You're Eeyore incarnate. Like, I don't know, we're all gonna die. You know, like, and that's a hard personality type, but that's the personality type, right? They're just kind of the nihilist. The previous one's the realist. They just kind of go, there is joy, but I don't know if it's real joy, and so they'll just cope. But then the nihilistic person is just like, there is no joy. There's no joy, right? So you have the hedonist, the existentialist, the rationalist, the nihilist, and then finally you have person five, the person who actually believes in joy but chooses joylessness. Who is this? The Methodist, right? No. right? So, no, but it's, well, all right. So, bad pastor. All right. So, but in some ways, this is more the cynic, right? It's the cynic. But in some ways, this starts to dance into our world as confessors of Christ, where we'll say, it's a book of joy. It's a gospel of joy. It's a God of joy. Paul exhibits tremendous joy. Doesn't matter the circumstance. People are for him or against him, as much, as little. He's in prison. He's out of prison. Doesn't matter. He's a joyful guy. We should be joyful people because we have a joyful God and a joyful gospel. So we believe in it, but then we don't exhibit it. There, preach it. Aha, finally. There it is, man. Now I've got joy. All right, so, but that's... And listen, by the way, when I say this, I'm talking to myself in the mirror. I'm a firstborn, I'm not a baby, right? Firstborns struggle with joy. We're always, oh, this is God, we're gonna die if we take this trip, you know? So we gotta have every contingency plan. And my wife is a baby, so she's just like, it's gonna be fun. I'm like, no, I need a plan, and a plan for a plan, and a plan for that plan, and I need to make sure that we don't die, you know? And so I just rob whatever joyful thing of joy really quickly, right? So, But when I think about it more and I read through the Bible more, especially doing Smash Bible, I'm like, wow, there's a lot of rejoicing. There's a lot of joyous and joy-filled and joy talk. And therefore, we should be people of amazing joy because we affirm it. We confess it. We aspire to it. We have a God who deposits it. But sometimes we just struggle with it. And so we find these different surrogates for the absence of joy. So the surrogate may be a relationship, or it may be an item or a thing or an accomplishment. You know, it's just any number of things that we say, I want this to make me not joyful, but at least happy. at least moderately sort of give me a smile. Just a little crack would be good enough for me. And what I find even in my own life is that sometimes I don't press for joy. I don't press toward the things that create joy, which we'll get into in a minute. And I don't let God have his work in me because, frankly, as I said earlier, joy is harder. To see joy established is harder. Now, it's more rewarding, like anything else. It's like working out or getting a degree or anything that you say is worthwhile and takes effort, but it's really worth it in the end. In the same way, joy is accessible and joy is worth it in the end, but it takes a different level of effort. And sometimes we go, you know what, I don't want that. It's too much, so I'm just going to settle for this lesser thing called happiness, and I'm going to go between the little waypoints of happiness, and I'm going to find my happiness on Sunday when the Seahawks win, or grief when they lose, and I'm going to move to the next little bit of happiness if this goes my way, or grief if it doesn't, and we just sort of keep licking crumbs off the ground of little happy bits. Because again, it's easy, where joy may be a little bit more difficult. Now, here's the thing about that when we kind of pursue maybe that type of runner-up, happiness over joy. One, it's doable, and two, it's doable without God. I don't want to say it isn't doable. People could be happy in this world. They can. Again, I go back to just go to Disneyland, you're going to be happy for about 5 minutes until your kids freak out and something bad happens. But you'll be happy when you're walking through the doors, you know. It'll be, oh, it's so awesome. Right? So we can find happy, and people without God can be happy. I know people who do not believe in God, do not care to believe in God, matter of fact, would say some pretty negative things about God, and they have happy times in their life. They can be happy. In fact, in Jeremiah, this is one of the frustrations that the prophet has, right? He's seeing the people of God be throttled by pagans. And in Jeremiah 12, this is from the New Living Translation, but he says, why are the wicked so prosperous, right? Why do evil people come across as so happy, right? Why are they so happy? He says, you have planted them and they have taken root and they have prospered. Your name is on their lips, but you are far from their hearts. He's frustrated by this. Why do the wicked do so well? Why do the wicked seem to always have fun? Why do the wicked seem to have more than the righteous do? The book of Ecclesiastes deals with the same problem. There's this frustration. And again, these are people apart from God, right? That's what it says. Man, your name is on their lips. It may even be cursing. But boy, their heart is nowhere near you. So why is this so fair? And I go back to it's fair because it's easy. Happiness is easy. Little bits of happiness is easy. But like I said, it's just little crumbs on a trail. And if you're just, you know, again, you're just going down the trail and you're, oh, here's a crumb of happiness, right? A holiday day with the family. That was happy. And then you go down to the next one. Oh, I got a raise. And that was really happy. And I go to the next one. And, oh, we're taking a family vacation. And that's really happy. But then you get here and you realize, oh, no, your wife has cancer. Or your child has an addiction. Or you lost your job. Or something else, and then suddenly now depression comes quickly, and anxiety comes quickly, and fatigue comes quickly, and worry comes quickly, and so you go, well, maybe there's another crumb here, and you go a little, and there's not another one there. If you don't keep finding a crumb of happy, you're going to suddenly get depleted very quickly. And so some people kind of live that crumb to happy, crumb to happy, crumb to happy, crumb to happy, and then suddenly they hit a dry spell where there is no crumb of happy. So you can have that without God, but there's some break in there coming, right? You're going to be getting older. Things are going to be changing. Circumstances are going to alter. And it can't be that I just go from waypoint of happy to waypoint of happy, because happy is a vapor. Happy is delicate. Happy is a balloon that is easily pricked. Happy is cotton candy. It tastes so good, but it melts so easily. But people in life can be happy, and then they can go from happy to unhappy in seconds. And that's why I'm saying happy is a poor substitute for joy. Now, it's a substitute. It's something that we usually substitute for joy all the time, but it's a poor substitute. Because all of those little happies don't build up to joy. You can't amass 10,000 little morsels of happy, and then from that you establish joy. Because again, they're very weak. They don't hold well. They come and go quickly. And much of this goes back to the fact that joy cannot be achieved or sustained apart from God. What did David say? In your presence, there is fullness of joy. Right? That was what he said. In your presence is fullness of joy. I have everything, but I don't have joy with that. All those different little things may be happy. Also, at times, those things are very depressing and sad. But in your presence is the fullness of joy. This is why I want to emphasize that joy is only experienced in proximity to God. It's only experienced in proximity to God. That's it. In fact, in Psalm 43, we see this scene, again, with David. And I'm giving you how people had joy in the Old Testament, right? If joy is about proximity, then there was something that you needed to be engaged in, that you needed to do. And so David is writing in this particular psalm, and he says, starting in verse 3, "Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling." So he says, let your light, which is going to be his word, his proclamation, his truth, let that guide me to where you dwell. He says, and then I will go to the altar of God, to my God, my what? My exceeding joy. Right? More than my crown or my throne or my warriors or my wife or whatever. He says, God is my exceeding joy. I will praise you there with the lyre. Oh, God, my God. Now, do you think he's having an easy life right now? No. Look at verse 5. He says, why are you cast down, oh my soul? I mean, David is dragging his butt into God's dwelling. This is not, hey, life is easy, it's perfect, it's awesome, he's happy, I think he'll go to the dwelling of God and hang out and get some joy. No, he's going discouraged and downtrodden and broken up, and he's coming and he's saying, you know, my soul is downcast, but I'm coming to God who is exceedingly joyful. He says, why are you cast down, oh my soul, and why are there turmoil within me? Then he preaches to himself, hope in God. For I again shall praise him, my salvation and my God. See, he's discouraged, but he preaches to himself, wait, hope in God. Why? Because I need to get to God, because where God is, there is joy. There's joy. So throughout that Old Testament period, whether it be tabernacle, whether it be temple, whatever it was, people had to go to where God was dwelling, and there, in a very kind of truncated and limited way, be experienced to the God of all joy, right? But in tandem to all of that period throughout the Old Testament, there was a promise. And the promise was to Abraham that in Abraham there would be a one and only son to come down the road, not Abraham's one and only son, but a one and only down the road, one promised in Genesis 3 originally, comes up again in Genesis 22, that there would be one who would come, and what would he do? It says, literally, he would bless the nations, right? He's going to bless the nations. Now, again, go back to what we learned at the beginning of the morning. What does blessed mean? Transcendently, infinitely happy. That God promised, I will make happy, truly happy, joyously happy the nations. Not shallow happy, not easy little trinket happy, profoundly happy. I will make joyous the nations. Because I send the one. So then we jump into the New Testament. We cross over into Luke chapter 2. And it's a scene that we all know because we celebrate it every Christmas. There's a scene where there's shepherds in their fields watching over their flocks by night. And we always kind of make that like, oh, how nice, it's shepherds. You know, nobody likes shepherds, right? Nobody like, not really. It's like if you were a shepherd, it's because you couldn't get another job. It was borderline what it was, right? They were hicks. They were uneducated. They were out in the fields all the time with animals. So people are like, they're not even social, man. You know, they don't chill and talk and hang out. They're just weird dudes. So weird, in fact, that there was even policies in place in the area that said, you know what, if there's any kind of legal problem, you can call whatever witness you want except for a woman or a shepherd, right? Because they're like, yeah, you don't trust shepherds. Nobody trusts shepherds. So it's interesting that the group of people that would have been seen as the most outcast and you couldn't use as a witness, that God says, you know what? Those are the ones I want to tell first. They're the ones that I want to be the witness to what I'm doing. So it says, starting in verse 8, in the same region there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not." And I'm like, right? If I'm seeing an angel when I'm just watching sheep, just bah, 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 you know, I'd be a little nervous. I'd have a great fear too. All right. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people." Notice that. I will bring you good news of great joy. Right? Just, if you smash Bible, you should put a little circle there and put that together. Good news. Gospel. What's the gospel? Great joy. Right? This joy that is elusive, this joy you don't experience, this joy you read about but you don't sense, the good news is great joy. It'll produce it in you. It brings it to you. Right? So it's good news of great joy. Right? And it'll be for all people. "For unto you, born this day in the city of David, is a Savior who is Christ the Lord." And so these shepherds who are nobodies, out in the middle of nowhere, are suddenly told something that is going to bring great joy. And so they gather everything up, and they go to see, right? And what do they see? They see Jesus. And who is Jesus? Jesus is God. And where God is, there's what? Great joy. There's great joy. So it says, and then they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph in verse 16, the baby lying in the manger, and they saw it, and then they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning this child, and all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured these things up, pondering them in her heart. What I love about that particular aspect of it is the angels come and make an announcement to these hicky shepherds. And then the shepherds take on the job of the angels, and then they go and they start telling other people, right? So they just pass it forward now. We were told this good news of great joy. Now we're telling you good news of great joy. We've seen this great joy. We want you to know about this great joy. So Mary treasures these things up in her heart, and then it says in verse 20, and the shepherds returned. Returned to where? To their stinky job, right? They returned to the dark, out in the field, with their sheep, in a position that's not respected, that nobody notices, that they're not a good witness. They go back to their old cruddy job, but they go back different. It says they returned glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen as it had been told to them. They came back with a different disposition, a different attitude. I'm sure before they were just kind of gnawing on straw and being a little irritable. And now there's great joy in their lives. Now there's praising and rejoicing and glorifying God. Why? Because where the presence of God is, there is joy. And they come back now changed. They're changed. And this is what I keep saying. It's because in the presence of God, there is a fullness of joy. Now, when Jesus comes into the world, these shepherds had no idea what it was that Jesus was fully bringing. They think, okay, we've come, we've seen this Prince of Peace, this hope for Israel, this joyous good news of the gospel. We've seen that. We're changed. But what they didn't realize is what Jesus would fully bring forth in his coming. In Colossians chapter 1, Paul is writing to a church he's never visited. And he's seeking to encourage them in their joy. So he says I'm going to start in verse 24, actually. It won't be on the screen, but I'm going to start there. Paul starts off by saying, "Now I rejoice in my suffering for your sake." We're talking about joy, right? So how does Paul kick this thing off? "I rejoice in my suffering for your sake." You know how many times we don't say that? How many times do we say, you know, "I'm rejoicing in my suffering. I'm rejoicing in my job loss. I'm rejoicing in my new, what the doctor has told me I have, what I'm struggling with. I'm rejoicing in my brokenness. I'm rejoicing." I mean, we don't do that. We're like, no, I needed to be happy to say that I'm being joy-filled. Paul says, "No, man, I rejoice in my suffering for your sake, and in my flesh I'm filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions." What he's saying there is, you know what? People, they killed Jesus. They wish he was still around to beat up on some more. He's not here to beat up on, so I get to take that place. They beat up on me, and I rejoice in that. That's what he's saying. He says, "I fill up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body. That is the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you to make the word of God fully known." that the mystery hidden from all ages and generations, but now has been revealed to his saints. What is this? That he chose to make known how great among the Gentiles the riches of his glory, this mystery that has been given. What is the mystery? The mystery that has been revealed, that Paul preaches, that brings him great joy, is that Christ is in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you. I highlight this because, again, in the Old Testament, what did you have to do? You had to hop a donkey or walk a road or whatever else to go to a place where God's presence was isolated to a temple or a tabernacle or whatever. And there, you couldn't even go all the way in to where the full presence was. You had to stand out in some segmented court, depending on where you were in the social strata, just to get some sense of presence where there's joy. And then Jesus comes into the world and he says, you know what, now here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to just dwell in you. You're going to be now my temple. You don't have to go to a temple. You are the temple. You don't have to visit my presence. My presence resides with you. This is the great mystery that's revealed. So when it comes to joy is found in the presence of God, what Paul is saying, and hey, good news, the presence of God is with you. This is why Paul rejoices even in the suffering, because he knew that presence. He experienced it. He enjoyed it. And see, this is the secret for us. The secret for us is saying, hey, man, Christ resides in us. The Holy Spirit dwells in us. The promise of the gospel is that God is with us. Emmanuel, right? And so with this, we have this opportunity for joy. Every day, abundant, infectious, contagious joy. So what do we need to do? First thing we need to do is this. Stop chasing happy all the time. Stop chasing happy all the time. That doesn't mean don't do things that are fun. I'm not saying don't do happy things. I'm going to Disneyland next week. This is the irony, all right? So I'm not saying don't do things that bring fun and happy times to life. But if that's all life is, I just chase happy to happy to happy to happy, then stop chasing happy. Because here's what happy is. Happy is it has to go outward. It has to find a thing outside and then pull it in, hoping that that's going to make you happy. And there are times where you reach and you pull and you're like, that didn't make me happy. Right? Have you ever impulse spent? Like, oh, this will make me so happy. You get it home and then you're looking at it going, I didn't open it yet. I can take it back, right? Oh, Amazon. How do I send it back without paying for shipping? I'll say it was wrong, right? So, like, you're like, how does he know that? All right, moving on. I need the gospel of grace. All right, so, right? But that's the thing. You have to go out and bring it in, right? It relies on perfect conditions. Happy relies on perfect conditions. You need everything to be just right. You ever tried to put together that family dinner? It was going to be just right. And then somebody came in angry. Something was burnt. All fell apart. You're just like, that's not happy anymore, right? Because the conditions weren't perfect. Happy focuses on how I feel. Do I feel happy or do I feel anxiety? Do I feel depressed? Do I feel sad? Do I feel worried? Do I feel bummed? Do I feel disappointed? Happy relies so much on feeling. And what I have found over the course of life is that happy is like this, it's like a Ponzi scheme that needs constant investment to keep going, right? That's the morsels on the ground. And as soon as there isn't some morsels, the Ponzi scheme falls apart and you move from happy to unhappy very quickly, right? And so one part of cultivating joy is stop chasing happy as the substitute. The other is to cultivate joy in the way that we see joy is cultivated. John 15, 11. Jesus says, these things I've spoken to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. You catch that? These things I've spoken to you that my joy may be in you. So not an earthly happy, not even an earthly joy. He says, my joy will be deposited, right? The God of infinite joy, right? The God where there are only pleasures forevermore at his right hand, that joy will be deposited in us. He says, so listen, I'm coming to give my joy to you and that your joy may be totally full. But he says, these things I've spoken so that. So in other words, there is something that we do to see this joy experienced. Now what I love about this joy is why it's different is where earthly happy looks out, this joy looks up, right? That's something different. This joy will always transcend conditions, always. What I love about this is that this joy focuses not on what I feel, but it does focus on what I know
what I believe.
This is where there are times where you need to preach to yourself, just like David did in Psalm 43, where he says, you know what, my heart is downcast and trodden, but I will hope in God. He says, I will go against the flow of my feelings and preach the truth to myself, right? There are so many times, man, I'll be driving home, I've had a bad day, I have a lot of concerns, a lot of worries, and I will literally just start out loud preaching verses to myself. Right? It doesn't even have to be related. You know what I mean? I'm like, in the beginning was the word. You know, and I'm like, it's not, it has nothing to do with my problems, but I'm just going to preach it. Right? And I just preach it to myself because it's like, man, you got to ground yourself. You tell yourself what you know, what you believe. And then the other part of this is just having a high view that God is in control, that he's sovereign over the affairs of life. You just have to kind of do those things. You tap into it. And when Jesus says, these things I've spoken to you, what he's saying is that joy comes through things like obedience, right? If we're choosing things that we know are not God's best, and we keep choosing these things that we know are not God's best, we shouldn't be surprised that we struggle with joy. Obedience produces joy. Scripture produces joy. Focusing on eternal reward versus temporal appeasement, that produces joy. We see that serving others produces joy. And joy just simply comes through Jesus and him exalted. There's just all kinds of verses just saying these are the ways that we pursue joy. We seek out joy. See, happiness is all about live to self and hopefully others will serve your interests. But joy is die to self and serve God and others. And from that, you are filled up. I read a quote from Malcolm Muggeridge that said this. He says, I can say that I never knew what joy was until I gave up pursuing happiness or cared to live until I chose to die. For these two discoveries, I am beholden to Jesus. Right? I didn't know what real joy was until I gave up choosing to pursue happiness. And I didn't even know what living was until I chose to die. Only joy can be produced by Jesus in a grief-smitten world, and that's why he came. He came to give it in John 17, verse 13. He says, but now I'm coming to you, and these things I speak in the world that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. This is why Jesus comes. We might go, Jesus came to save us, Jesus came to rescue us, Jesus came to forgive us. We don't often say, and Jesus came to give us joy. But that's exactly what he says. My mission was to give you joy. To give it to you. And not so you can sequester it to yourself and say, whoo, inside my house, I am so joy-filled. He says, I came to give you joy so that you can give that joy to others. This is why in that same text, no sooner does he say, I've come to make sure that my joy is fulfilled in you, than in verse 18, he says, as you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. So Jesus says, I've come to give you joy in verse 13. And then in John 17, 18, he says, and then I send them into the world. Why? To be different. We're sent into the world to be different. And what is the way that we can be most different? In a world choosing and chasing happiness, we press into our God, we dwell in his presence, and we're filled with his joy. That's how we're different. Now, does this mean that joy is always going to be easy? No, like I said, joy is worthwhile and joy is a pursuit. That's why obedience and scripture and serving and seeking after God are all the sources of joy. So it is a worthy pursuit, but it's not an easy pursuit. But it is a worthy pursuit. In fact, even right now, we're going to have communion. And as we take communion, I want to challenge us in saying that communion, in part, communicates to us the process toward joy. Right? We think upon what communion is all about. Communion is about Jesus who says, you know what, in the upper room on that final night, I'm going to give my body for you. I'm going to shed my blood for you. I'm going to take all of your offenses, every one of your sins on me, and I'm going to suffer the hell of those offenses. I'm going to do that. Right? None of this sounds good. This is why in the garden, he's praying and he's pleading and he's filled with anxiety, it says in Luke, and he's sweating so profusely, it says, it's like great drops of blood. I mean, there is an intensity, there is an anxiety, there is a turbulence in him about what he's going to do for us. And we could look at that and say, there's no joy in that. How is there any joy in his sacrifice? How is there any joy in Jesus for what he's going to do for us? How do we take communion even in a spirit of joy, knowing the turbulence of his soul? Well, you look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, and it says, "For the joy set before him, he endured the cross." For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. He knew that this series of events, this series of choices, this series of sacrifices would produce in him great joy. Great joy. Not easy. Worth it. Worth it. Paul knew in all of his sacrifice, filling up in himself the afflictions that are intended for Christ, that that would bring him great joy. He would rejoice, and he would tell others, "I'm telling you, rejoice." He says, "I've given up the pleasures of chasing happy. I've given up the pursuit of lesser things. I have found the God in whom there is all joy and is all delight and is all pleasure, and I'm not going back to the lesser things when I found the more. I found the more. I would never want to go back to those things again." And so with us, as we take this bread and as we take this cup and we reflect on sacrifice, we reflect on his pain, we have to tell ourselves, for the joy set before him, he endured. And therefore, if that is true of Jesus, how much more can that be true of me? For the joy that is set before me in him, I endure a pursuit that sometimes is not easy, but will always, always result in the guarantee of joy. We're going to go ahead and pass out the elements right now, and you can just hold them. We'll all partake together in just a moment. But I just want you to stop, and I want you to rejoice. As you have this cup and this bread in your hand, I want you to actively rejoice. And you may say, you don't know what's going on in my life. My life is not easy. There are family problems and money problems and health problems and just circumstance problems, whatever it is. And I want to challenge you to rejoice anyway, to thank anyway, to celebrate anyway, because you are in the presence of the God of all joy.